Thanks, eSignal. Ben, good job holding everything together there. Let me action pack this 20 minutes that I have remaining and talk about the social boom. In 2006, this boom started with YouTube. And then we had obviously Facebook and Twitter, and now we have the verticalization of all these networks with companies like Reddit and hopefully StockTwits. Today, StockTwits is thriving, 100,000 daily active people, over 500,000 people have signed up and contributed ideas. And Ben gave you a pretty good screenshot of how simple it is to share. One thing I think is super important is journaling. All the great traders have journaled. And in 2007, when I started using Twitter, I was inspired by the 140 characters. And thought that as silly as it would be to share what I'm eating or where I am, that people would want to share ideas around tickers. And that was the inspiration for, and I will share the presentation later, everybody. But let's keep it simple, right? We had a great detailed presentation before. I like to think of things in much bigger ideas and much longer term trends. And so with StockTwits and now eSignal incorporating StockTwits, people from around the world in real time can share their thoughts and ideas and get feedback in incredible speed. There's thousands of great traders. We have full-time staff, Stefan, Sean, myself, because we love trading ourselves on the streams all day. So my idea of creating StockTwits was a place to journal. In 2015, we've been working all year 2014 on this. In 2015, it will become apparent why you've been sharing all these years socially, especially on StockTwits when we launch Elasticsearch. We'll be able to retrieve all your ideas that you've shared over the years. And if you're just starting today, ShareAway will be able to pull up all your ideas. So if you want to search Howard Nike or Howard Apple and pull up all the times that I've just mentioned that ticker, you'll be allowed to. My inspiration for trend following is really more out of how poorly I was as a short-term trader. And as I've gotten older and tried everything, I'm much more comfortable as a trend follower. To me, there's four key things to trend. The first being price. Price to me is the ultimate indicator. There's a lot of talk around the web with respect to big data. I think of price as small data. It's accumulation of all these data points that now in real time we can get free price. But at the same time, I look at price of small data. Everybody has the same piece of data. We're all looking at the same thing. And so price is still the most significant part of a trend following system for entries and for exits. Volume, the second, the X and Y axis, volume has always been a great indicator. I think since 2008, since technology has moved a lot of volume off network into dark pools, into options, into global markets and ETFs, volume has not been as great an indicator in many of the markets as volume has moved off market. And of course, during the same time where volume around stocks has not been as reliable an indicator, this social dimension, the social boom that I talked about earlier, the social dimension of who said what has become super important. Meaning, Carl Icahn, for example, a master at using social media. He is now gone to the broadcast platform of Twitter. And at StockTwits, we quickly, when we're following, or anybody in the world following him, quickly shares his ideas. So instead of having to book time on CNBC or talk to the Journal or Bloomberg about his ideas, he can post them on Twitter. And now so many tens of thousands of people are following him that he can move markets in 140 characters. And that's the beauty, right? It's, up until 2007, 2008, broadcast was controlled by Bloomberg, Reuters, even let's say CNBC. But since 2007, 2008, and we're seeing a lot now with Ackman and the Herbalife battle with Icahn, this who, this third dimension of what I call this social volume dimension, who, what, when, where, why, and how, and ability to track these people has become the ultimate third dimension. So armed with price, volume, and who, which is StockTwits, and also Twitter, which is another one I use, we really can dumb down systems and really hone in on my favorite ideas. For me, with price, I like to look at 3-year highs, if not 5-year and all-time highs. So for me, it doesn't even get interesting, doesn't even get put on a list for me until a stock is, hitting 3 or 5 year highs. Preferably, I like to see all-time highs. The old saying, especially around relative strengths, stocks that are doing well generally continue to do well. So price to me still remains the ultimate indicator. And I say that because I do all my list checking. I've throttled everything back to just give myself 3, 5 year all-time highs. So that's my initial tool. I don't use any special Bloomberg. I don't use anything but StockTwits and Twitter for news to manage, well over $100 million and have obviously hundreds of millions of dollars in people's money following stuff that's going on the stream. So price gives me that initial list. Then the most important thing to me is investing in things that I know. So from that list of all-time highs or 5-year highs, I like to find companies that I'm immersed in the catalysts of. So one easy one for me has been Nike. For the last 3 or 4 years, the stock has been consistently making all-time highs. There's periods of digestion, but for me, Nike is one of those companies that I'm immersed in. I have two kids. They live in Nike and Under Armour. I travel the world. Today I got off a plane. All I notice are people's shoes, Nike running shoes for travel. And so for me, the catalysts have been around Nike have been both obviously the global brand. Technology has come into becoming a huge benefit, a huge, what would I call it, leverage tool for Nike. The cost of their materials continue to drop. The product gets lighter and lighter, more personalized, easier to ship, cost of shipping going down, oil prices dropping right now. Continued catalyst for this global brand. So again, price, that's where I start. That's where I get my curated ideas. And I don't really like to follow more than 30 to 50 ideas at a time. Also, for context, I like to really keep track of how many stocks are making all-time highs. And really, if you're a beginner, it's going to take 3 to 6 months to get a feel for how many stocks are making all-time highs in context. So if hundreds of stocks continue to make 5-year, 3-year all-time highs, you're in a good market, a target-rich market, and therefore, it's time to put money to work. From there, number two for me are companies that I understand, the catalyst. You know, one of the biggest trends I've ever missed is in biotech, but because I don't understand the businesses themselves, and it's hard for me to get my head around, you know, how they're valued in the binary, excuse me, outcomes of FDA reports and the drugs being passed on from stage to stage. I've avoided that. And, you know, to be a great investor, sometimes you just have to miss some of these trends. You can't catch all of them. So the key for me, again, price, the catalyst, and then a combination of the volume, who is chattering, and when they're chattering, and then generally that the consistency of that person. You know, it's easy on StockTwits for me to go and see how often the style of the contributions from any one one person. So I'm going to open it to questions. It's easy to find me on the StockTwits stream. It's easy to find me pretty much 24/7 on the streams. If you at Howard Lindzon, you will find it. You will find me, and I'm pretty good within 24 hours of getting people back that use our product. To give you some ideas that are working right now, software continues to work. Workday, one of the great companies of the next era, human resource CRM software. We're seeing it with Zendesk as well, Zen. Workday is Wday, and Zendesk is Zen. I don't own those stocks right now, but I've been following them a real long time. And if the market stays strong here, those are two that are on my watch list. Another stock showing up really well, although I don't own it, is Salesforce. You know, a lot of people talk about how, you know, price to earnings, price to sales are, you know, way too high. But again, the stock continues to show strength. And what they've done is locked down the future of enterprise software and CRM. So I see a lot of strength there. Obviously, the biotech sector continues to be strong. And then retail and apparel, like Nike, Under Armour, and some of these retail stocks continue to be strong. Stefan's on the stream right now. He's always here to help you find great people. And I really do apologize about the audio difficulties at the beginning of this, which kind of threw us all off here at the beginning of the webinar. But it's really a 24/7 support desk. And now with eSignal integration, if you're using eSignal, it's just a great interface to be able to go in and share ideas into StockTwits, get feedback back, whip back and forth. I really get, like I said, the who said what about those stocks. Really find some people that you can lock in with in a group and attack the markets. So Ben, why don't you see if there's any question for me? I like to keep things really simple. I don't really dive that much deeper into markets than what I've really talked to you about. I like to keep my list small, and I like to keep my positions, you know, under 10 to 15, even in a bull market. So fire away with any questions. Ben, thanks for your patience here.
Sure, no problem, Howard. So I think I'm not sure, Howard, if you responded to Pavel's question where he mentioned you mentioned four dimensions: price, volume, social dimensions. What is the fourth?
Well, no, sorry. Price and volume have been the two dimensions, Ben. And with the advent in 2007 with Facebook and Twitter, we had this 24/7 global customer support, this global social dimension. And what StockTwits has done with the dollar sign and with, you know, a curated platform to talk in short form around stocks, we've added that third dimension for stocks. So the third dimension is social. There was always the price and volume. In 2008, really volume after the crisis, volume has moved off the exchanges. You know, if you go look at the New York Stock Exchange, if you're ever watching CNBC or get a picture of it, it's empty. You know, everything got distributed. And so what StockTwits does is bring everybody back together. And with eSignal plugging into our API and so many other companies like Fidelity and the brokers plugging into our API, we're re-establishing this hub, this group of hundreds of thousands of traders that in real time are talking about the market. So this social dimension, it's really just three dimensions. And to be honest, I can live off, if I were to give up one of those dimensions, it would just be general volume, you know, exchange volume. I would live off price and StockTwits, the social volume. And that's pretty much 90% of what I do. Does that help answer your question?
I hope so, Paul. Please respond if that answers your question. The next question I see from Bree is, how do you read your heat map? So, folks on the screen, I'm obviously sharing my screen, and you can see the social signals heat map. Howard, can you speak a little bit more about how can users read the heat map on StockTwits?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're a little biased towards technology just because, you know, it's a technology platform. So I think for the last 5 years, and you know what? Maybe just, you know, the stream has been correct. You know, a lot of people like to fade the stream, and I'm like, you know, the StockTwits stream, about 80% of messages, we don't share this data publicly, but about 80% of the messages since about 2009 have been bullish. You know, if they could be tagged one way or the other. And that's with all kinds of algorithms to filter out spam, etc. So the streams have been pretty bullish. They've leaned technology and healthcare for the last 3 to 4 years. So what you do is you open up the heat map. You can kind of see where the action is. I prefer personally to use the trending tickers, you know, on my iPhone app or people have a Droid app. I really just at the top of the website, or if I open the, you know, I really get to see a curated list of, yeah, it's right underneath the logo, right under the search bar, you have the 10 to 12 trending tickers. That really gives me a feel for what's happening in the market. We're really going to spend a lot of time on mobile and are about 30 days away from our iOS launch, really giving people a tighter look of why things are trending in the original. So you don't have to dive in too deep, but really we give you a great feel of what 100,000 daily active people are talking about, and we remove penny stocks. So stocks under $5 cannot trend on StockTwits. Maybe one day we'll add small caps, but because I don't trade small caps, I can't. Kind of in the vision of myself who started the company, we've avoided small cap stocks and a lot of the spam and aggravation that goes along with that. You know, I've always felt that, along with IBD, the Investor's Business Daily, that, you know, stocks over $10 to $15 are the ones that I generally own. 80 to 90% of the stocks I own are over $15. Occasionally, I'll buy a $10 to $15 stock, but you know, we generally curate it down to that stock, those type of stocks. So anything that you see on our trending ticker is where the focus is right now. And no, Richard, penny stocks to me are, you know, under $2. But one of our rules of trending tickers is stocks over $5. So, for example, Plug, PLUG, has been trending for over a year in terms of amount of messages, but really didn't start showing up on the trending bar until it hit over $5. Ben, other questions?
Folks, this is a good opportunity for you to send in any final questions to Howard. And again, we're trying to stay on schedule, so if we can't get to your question, please shoot an email to esignalproducts@interactivedata.com. Send it to a subject line, put attention Ben David, and I will route your direct questions to the appropriate presenter and respond back to you through that email or through a follow-up email separately, okay? Again, that email is
Ben, yeah, sure. Ben, the one main question is, you know, for people using Twitter, why their messages from Twitter don't show up on StockTwits. And that's more an indication of these social wars going on. StockTwits has made StockTwits has always had a pretty open API, and as Twitter has grown and they've done this to LinkedIn and Instagram and vice versa, the Twitter made it very difficult under the way we would have to display their messages to pull in their messages. So there's lots of easy ways, including eSignal, to post messages from StockTwits into Twitter, but we no longer pull in messages from Twitter, and that's mainly because of the terms of use of Twitter. So there's, you can pop out a stream. Stefan will show you. I unfortunately can't show you a demo linked, but you can just pop out a message box either in Chrome or just from the website and just use StockTwits as a message platform. And then people are asking still about the heat map, and I apologize for not giving a concise answer because I don't really, I really use the trending bar and not the heat map. The heat map breaks it down by sections, and what I find is that, yeah, Ben, if you pull up the actual heat map there, the tab above stocks there, we break it down by where, we've broken down the stocks into different sectors. And, for the last 3 to 5 years, it's been healthcare and technology, just to the left there of your arrow, that have been leading. And Dan, the reason I use Twitter so often is because I cover a lot more than just stocks. I like to talk about news and goof around, and StockTwits isn't where I want to do that, and that's generally on Twitter. And also, Dan, I invest in startup companies. In a lot of the technology industry, the people who don't trade stocks that invest in startups and a lot of the founders use Twitter. And so from a brand building perspective, that's why I use Twitter. But all my stock ideas I share on StockTwits. So I would say about 50% of all my stock ideas are on Twitter, 100% are on StockTwits.